The Benins have never disagreed at one point in their history that we never went to Ife. But we always said that the boy or the child that came with us from Ife, Romania, his father is a Benin man. And the Yorubas doesn't want to talk about Oduduwa and where he came from, other than the fact that he fell from heaven. All right, because when you don't have facts to back up history, you start to propagate, you start to give mythological identity to a real person. So I think that's what happened. First, I want to make it clear that the other relationship that the Benins and the Yorubas had was that we gave them their first king, and in return, the first king, who was the Oduduwa, brought his son back to Benin that started the second dynasty. Otherwise, everything that Yoruba has in terms of almost all the structured kings of Yoruba ancestry traces their ancestry to Oduduwa. It therefore means that most of the prominent kings in Yoruba land ancestrally Benin. All right, so I want to first of all establish that, because by the time we are talking about how Akalaka left Benin, and then some people said, okay, fine, Akalaka, yeah, the Benin man, but the Benin themselves are Yoruba. So I want to first of all establish that we have had a structured monarchy for a period of 834 years before Yoruba ever had Oduduwa. So, and we had 31 kings before Oduduwa ever appeared in the history of Yoruba. So I wonder how a people who had close to 900 years of history, structured leadership, goes to a foreign land to take a people who had no leader to come and lead over them. So it just doesn't make sense. So Benins, other than we gave them Oduduwa, Benins don't have any other relationship to do with the Yoruba people. So first I needed to establish that, because I seen some of our brothers argue on Facebook as to Benin coming from Yoruba. No, that's why I wanted to pull that first. Now, Benin, as our brother said, is one of the largest empires in this part of the world. Of course, he mentioned Togo. Actually, the empire got to Ghana, all right? It terminated at the mouth of River Volta. So when he stretched it down from River Volta down to River Focados and Bayelsa, it's almost taking half of the entire West Africa. So our ancestors dominated almost half of the entire West Africa. So that's how mighty we have history, and it's in history we should be proud of. We shouldn't be shying away from that history and connecting our history to Igbos, who don't have history to brag about. They don't have history. They're trying to force this old Inri priest, some set of priests who were never really kings, who never had a kingdom, not think of having ever to build an empire. So these are some of the things that we must look critically. We understand that for whatever the British structure this country to favor some ethnic nationalities as against us, the only crime we ever committed as a people was that when the British, the foreigners, were invading this part of the world, we were about the only tribe that stood against them and said that you are a foreigner, you can't take to us in our land. And so because of that, they never forgave us. So some of the militias that was used to conquer Benin, Yorubas were part of the military forces that was used to conquer Benin. The Hausas were also part of the military forces they used to conquer Benin. So in order for them to entirely submit the very history of our ancestors, they had to remove that power in a way and put it in the hands of their allies. We are not their allies, we will never be. And so they now give them the tag of majority. But we are trying to bust their lies by identifying all these Benin people who left for different historical reasons. It could have been that the house was not favorable. Obviously, if the house is too big, they are bound to be quarrels. And when they are quarrels, you just pack your load and leave. It's a good thing. If Akalaka had not left, Benin Empire would have gotten to this part. So it's actually a good thing that some of these great warriors left for different historical reasons to establish a country of their own. So it is good for the expansion of the Benin ideology. So I am more than just being excited to be here, to be able to tell all of us that we must find a way to break that barrier of differences. I think that's what the British did to us. They try to create a barrier. Oh, you are from Edo State. You're from River State. Automatically, even if an Igbo man is in River State with you, the Igbo man seems closer to you than your real people in Edo State. So, creation of regions and creation of states was a systematic way the British used in creating divisions amongst ancestrally connected people like us. So we are more than excited because sometimes some persons come out online and say that we are not Benin, even if we know that in reality they are. But because of it is easier for you to now identify with the so-called majority tribe and then to now identify with the so-called minority tribe, who in real sense is not minority. So I'm going to prove here that in real sense the Benins are not minority. All right, it's just that we have Benin in Inworonha version, then we have Benin Benin version, then we have Benin Esan version, we have Benin Ekpe version, we have Benin in part of Ishekiri version, we have Benin in Urobo, we have Benin in Usoko, Isoko, we have Benin in Degema. We in Degema November last year. We well received. They're proud Benin people, and they are very, very proud about it. We've been to Ika, we've been to Anuma, and we've had fellowship with kings, Iseluku, Onichaovu, and all that. We have fellowship with some of their kings. They all testify to their Beninness. Now, even cutting across to the West, the old Benin Empire had a boundary with the old Oyo Empire at Otun, present-day Ekiti State. So, Ekiti, it's almost the boundary between Ekiti and Kwara State. So that means almost the entire Ekiti State down to this way was all controlled at one point by ancestors. So we had Ondo, Ondo, the proud Edo people. They had some Yoruba influences and all that. But a lot of population in present-day Ondo State still attested to their Benin origin. So obviously Lagos, we founded, ancestors founded and owned Eko. It's with their deception. They're trying to tell us that there were people who settled there. Then the Benin people came there to fight them and remove them from the land. That wasn't true. My argument is that what was that name of that land before the Benins named it Eko, which is the original name? So, and what was the name of the war? When you fight war with aborigines, there was supposed to be a recorded event that led to that war. No such war, there wasn't a formal name, no record that the Benins met people there. The only record that we have is that when one of our ancestors, who was a seafarer, trained in Portugal, Obarugua, when he got there because he was expanding the empire through the coastline, he was the one who expanded the empire certainly to Ghana. He needed, because the house was not very far, Benin was very far off, he needed to establish a camp so as to station part of its military wings to further expand the empire coastline westward. Eventually, definitely it wouldn't have been called a camp. What the Benins call camp is a coup. Alright, so which is the original name for that place, Lagos. So these are more than facts and proofs that one way or the other, we are not minority. That's why that should be our focus, that we are not minority. We can only be minority as a people if we start to segregate ourselves just the way it was designed by the British to separate us into different ethnic nationalities. While we maintain our present ethnic nationalities, we must associate with what is most important, blood. All right, where we ancestrally come from, because that is exactly where our history starts from. And they're trying to tell you that Akalaka is an Igbo name. We said no, it isn't. But the only difference is that since this name has passed through years of history, there are bound to be a little twist of names. The only thing that was missing it's the L and the N. In Benin, Akanaka. Alright? Akanaka means something precious. That's what the Benin call something precious. So it must have been a very precious warrior to one of the other. and that's why. So basically, the second song, Opa. Alright. We have a town called Opa. Oba.
Oba.
Oba. And we have a town called Opa.
In America.
Yes, in Benin.
In Benin.
Oh, right.
Probably that second song would have been named from the hometown, which we believe
he came from.
Came from. That's Opa. So one of these days, when you guys, when we host you guys, we'll take you to your official community. And so that you can familiarize them. Yeah, historical fact. We are not going to beckon on propaganda. We're not going to beckon on a recent British creation. We're going to beckon on something that has existed for more than 400 to 500 years. We're going to beckon on facts. It is not a time where people can separate us because they believe that they are majority or they believe they have an agenda that doesn't go beyond the figment of the imagination. The real deal is actually us and not them. And we must understand that until it was the conquest of our ancestors that gave birth to Nigeria. The conquest. If Benin was not conquered, there wouldn't have been a place, a country called Nigeria. So inherently we gave birth to Nigeria. So, and we have tested sovereignty for more than 1,700 years as a established country before we lost our sovereignty in the year 1897. So a group of people who doesn't even know what a country looks like, quote me anywhere. It's not recorded that Igbo ever had any sovereign. They never had leadership, a structured leadership. When you don't have a structured leadership, you can't have a place called a country or a nation. So our ancestors had a country, a nation, structured. We perfected monarchical government for a period of almost 2,054 years and counting. And it is in that life that we have been a sovereign nation until we lost our sovereignty in 1897 to the British. So we understand what a country should look like, and we are supposed to be the one to tell those who doesn't understand what a country to look like how a country to look like, not the other way around. It's just like a 2 years old baby telling a 70 years old man what old age or experience of life is. And we must tell them, not with quarrel, not with propaganda, but with the truth, that while we are sovereign, while we will come together as a people, when we come together as a people, that is when we can really see the beauty of being together, of the beauty of having to build a nation together. So it is possible in future, we are envisaging it. We're going to work together with IFM.
Sure.
We're envisaging that when there should be clamoring of a true country, it has to be all the Benin descendants coming together to actually chart a common cause for themselves. Not some bunch of miscreants coming online to disturb the peace of an already established country like Nigeria. So, I want to thank all of you for this little time, and I like talking history.
Can you tell us the meaning of your...
Okay. Alright, this is how it works. Now, if a father in circumstances to give names to our children, it happens. It's still till date. And so that would have accumulated. It's all the circumstances that warrant a Benin man to give Onaewu or Uwiriona. Onaewu, this one will not die. Uwiriona, death will not take this one. The same name, however, you take it. And Uwiriona is actually perfect, pure Benin word that means death will not take this. So, because of the fact that they know that you are pure Benin people, they try to give you an alien antecedent by making the word Ikwerre stick. But it is the duties that lies upon us. FFK came out and challenged the entire Yoruba race that from this day forward, I will no longer be known as a Yoruba man. Because I haven't discovered what Yoruba means from Hausa, Fulani, Yariba, that means treacherous people, people not straightforward. However, they're not straightforward though, but I don't know whether that name actually stopping them. It's affecting them. So he just felt that, yeah, the name has a way of changing people's destiny, that we are not truthful people. So, okay, the only way the name could not affect other younger generations, let's go back to our original word, probably Aku or more Oduduwa. But it still will show that they are also believe. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you that Akalaka was a man from a community called Oba. Alright? Who left for the reason of being uncomfortable. He wasn't about the older person. Even the founder of the Warring Kingdom also left. He was a crown prince, he was the next Oba of Benin, by virtue of his right as the royalty. But there was a problem. He gave a counsel to his father that some very influential nobles disagreed with. And they sworn to his father that no matter what, when his father sojourned, you know, Benin kingship is hereditary, father to son, but they said, we are not going to allow your first son to take this one, because if he can give you an advice as a crown prince, if he comes the Oba, he's probably going to kill everybody in this kingdom. So who will not allow this? His father knew that if he passes on his first child, will not be allowed to become the next Oba. So instead, he now told him, be the king beside the water in Benin. That one means Ogiame. So Ogiame, if you hear Ogiame, yes, you'll lower it. Ogiame is not an Ishakiri word, it's a pure Benin word. Ogi, king, ame, water, Ogiame. So be the king beside the water in my vast empire, since Benin is not like getting too close to water. So you go beside that water and become a king there. So the original kingship title for the kings of Warri is not Olu, it's Ogiame. The present one, a friend who were with him 3 weeks ago, so Ogiame Ikenwole. Alright, when we try to give him the grand patron of Association of Great Benin Descent 3 weeks ago, I think the video is out there. And he said, I can't accept that. If my father, Yoruba of Benin, is still there, I can be the grand patron of an association that is an umbrella to all Great Benin descendants. I accept to be a patron, but the Yoruba of Benin, my father, is the grand patron. Just like the Oni of Ife is supposed to also do to the Oba of Benin, just like Alafin of Oyo, which is every Alafin of Oyo is a younger brother, every Oba of Benin. That is not in dispute. Alafin of Oyo doesn't argue that. Oromia, a Benin prince, came to Benin, gave birth to a son, and left. Went to Oyo, gave birth to other 2 sons, Ajaka and Shango. So every Alafin of Oyo, the 2 lineage or the 2 houses that produces every Alafin of Oyo is Ajaka and Shango. And these Ajaka and Shango are younger brothers of Eweka, who was born in Benin. So every Alafin of Oyo is the younger brother of every Oba of Benin. So these prominent kings understand. I think we did a press conference recently, Emeka, where we're trying to tell the honorable Ife that the matter that concerns Oduduwa, it should no longer be discussing it, because we understand that everyone needs of Ife are not connected to Oduduwa. They're not connected to Oduduwa. So those who are connected to Oduduwa should talk on Oduduwa matters, not a stranger who was meant to, because every children of Oduduwa left the house, then I said Oni. Oni means someone who stays at home, a homestayer. So, and let me not bother you with all this. I love this field. But the point I'm trying to raise is that even those ethnic nationalities that tells you Jack and Jill of how great they are, were submerged. The questions we ask, I will give you 15 different books where it was stated different times where Benin defeated every of these ethnic nationalities around. When the Oba of Benin visited the Sultan of Sokoto last year, the Sultan of Sokoto said something. He said, aside politics, Oba of Benin is number one. In closed door. And someone who was there actually told me this 2 weeks ago. He said, aside politics, you are number one in this country. See, because during the days of the Sultanate, when it was expanding, only one king stopped. Alright? The Caliphate of the Fulani. It was the Oba of Benin. And it was not through war, as a matter of fact. I remember the story very well. It was Obadola, who was the father of Obaburamen, Obada was the post of Calabar. What happened was that he heard that there were some people were ravaging through the northern part, almost into his vast empire. He said, I'm not going to give them war. It is not important. But go and tell them that with all their war conquests, they should dig the soil under their feet. If they find a red sand, know that it is my territory. They should back off. That was the only message of Obada was sent. And eventually, that's exactly what happened. So when the dog, if it gets into almost Auchi, the dog, the sand, it was a red soil, and I was like, okay, this is the territory of this nigger. Sorry, I'm using the word nigger. This is the territory of this all-powerful king, and it went back. So in reality, politics have made traditional institutions not to know their mates anymore. Otherwise, nobody ever defeated the Benin ancestors in any war. Obviously, we're ravaging Igbo territories. That's the quarrel that they have with us. They don't like us because they said we made immense out of them, made slaves, sold them as slaves to the transatlantic. Yes, a lot of them emailed me that. Are you not saying that we can never forgive you people for what you people did to our ancestors? I told them that's imperialism. That's imperialism. If I'm stronger than you, I'll beat you and take everything. That's imperialism. So it wasn't, you can't blame me. You have to blame your ancestors for being
weak.
Yeah, thank you.
You can't blame me. And that's the reality. You can't blame me. Alright? So if you were able to beat my ancestors, you would have sold my ancestors as slaves. We defeated you and we sold you as slaves. Not just only them, we sold your ass as well. So that means imperialistic. Now I tell them, tell me any war fought between Benins and Yorubas, between Benin and Igbos, every other tribes around, that we were defeated. Nobody is able to tell. The only one war we lost was to the British in 1897. So it was a blow that was too devastating, you know. The people was used to winning, they eventually lost. So we've been still grieving till recently when GBD came out and said, you can no longer grieve anymore. We have to tell the world that the Benin people have to come back in a very united format, and that's exactly why we're here. We're here to tell our Akalaka brothers, our Inwoha brothers, blood brothers, that our relationship with them is not created by the British. It's ancestral, it is a bloodline relationship, and we are the very future of our land, and the onus lies upon us for we to take the bull by the horn by saying that whatever alien antecedent that has been given to us by whoever, we are saying capital rejectamenta to it, and this is who we are, this is who we must accept, and we must come together as one people to chart a futuristic goal for the greatness of the Imura people and the Benin people. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Wonderful speech. I want to say some things. As you can see, look at the pride in me. Look at the names. Akanaka.
Akanaka.
Precious. We are precious people. Yahweh, death will not take you. Do you know what that means? Your foundation. That is why we are strong people. Death will not take us. Death will steal us and run away.
Yes.
You see it? This is the source of our courage, source of our strength, our power. You see where we come from? You see this lineage of strong warriors, conquerors, people that subdued, people that call themselves majority tribes today. We are winners. We'll always be winners. They have never lost a war. Our ancestors have never lost a war. Has Yahweh ever lost a war?
No.
You see, that is why everything we do, we achieve it. Just like nothing, anything we want to do, we achieve it.
Indeed.
We told people we would bring in the sensation, we did it.
Yes.
They doubted us, we did it.
Yes.
You see why we did it? Because we are precious and death can never kill our dreams.
Yes.
Oh. That is why we are successful. Yes. Marvelous!
Marvelous!
So, thank you very much for this wonderful speech. Mr. President, you really tried a lot to see our people learn a lot today. I just want, please, to bring up a Q&A session. Question and answers. Please don't be shy. Our brothers came all the way from Great Benin to see us. Please, everyone should ask a question. Anything, anything at all. Please, now is the time to ask questions. The floor is yours. Please.
I have a call.
Thank you.
Do I bring you call, but the person sent you a message.
Okay.
You have one question?
Yes.
Don't worry, just
go. IFM.
If you call, if you call, just send.
Rob first. IFM.
Yes. President, I'm so elated for hearing some of this apart from you. Out there, people are saying so many things, especially the Soma, we call them Soma. Somebody like me, I'm always out there for them. But there is something. They also, because this is a content, this is a question they always through to me, which I would also like to put it across to you now. From the books I've read concerning Great Benin Kingdom, I was made to understand that somebody from Onitsha was a king, was an Oba, which is Iweka. That Iweka is from Onitsha.
Okay,
it's an Igbo man.
Okay.
So, that after all, an Igbo man from Anambra was an Oba of Benin. So please, I would like you to throw more light on this.
Okay, alright. That sounds funny. I've heard one or two persons raise that. You know, these people are very funny people. As a matter of fact, it's possible that if that Iweka came from Eweka. First of all, there's not that Iweka in the It's Eweka. And how you answer them is simple. You know, Benin kingship is straightforward. Unlike most other kingship, our own is express primogeniture. Father to son.
First son.
First surviving son. So what that means is that Iweka couldn't have. Eweka's father was Oromi. He was Oromi and an Igbo man.
No.
I think that answers the question.
Yes, yes.
Abi?
Yeah.
So because it's Benin is hereditary from father to first surviving son. That means Eweka's grandfather is Oluwa. Eweka's great grandfather is Obiso Owodo.
Okay.
These are not Igbos. So, except they want to tell us that Obiso Owodo was an Igbo man, Oduduwa was an Igbo man, Oromia was an Igbo man. That would make Eweka an Igbo king. Alright? So I think we should move to the
next question. Please. Okay, we have one here, please.
Thank you very much, sir, for your historical insight. My question is, over the years, we believe that the rural people, and definitely there will be some kind of nature, in terms of language, culture, other social lifestyle, minister. Although I know that it has taken a very long period of time, definitely most of our the present generation might have forgotten most of those cultures and languages. Please, can you just emphasize, like, getting to tell us more of those cultures, more of those newer cultures that we are in similarity with the Chinese?
Okay. All right, I think that's a very good question. But the perfect way to answer it the tribe. You know, we are also on social media. We face the wall all the time. And the tribe said, okay, you guys said you came from Benin, but your languages are not similar. Your cultures are not similar. True. True. I give you a very good example. Very simple, very good example. The Oba of Lagos came out there all the time. He's a proud Benin man. But the Oba of Lagos doesn't speak Benin. He speaks Yoruba. There's still some artillery, because since it's an offshoot of the Oba, there's still some concept of the monarchical evolution of the Ko people that still retains part of its Benin heritage, but not absolutely. Some of the festivals being practiced there, they're more or less like a Yoruba festival, because when you are surrounded by people, for example, if your ancestors have migrated, so probably Germany, I'm not going to say 300 years, so this too, just 100 years. You're born to be behaving like German and speaking fluent German, no doubt about it. Alright? But it doesn't change the fact that you and I, you won't have man. It doesn't. So languages are not instruments to showcase one's ancestral connection. Urubos are ancestrally Benin, but they don't speak Benin anymore. Alright? They evolved. Isokos are also. Alright? Begemans are also. Alright? Part of these Yoruba speaking people are also Ikale and several other places in Yoruba. Yeah. They are also Benin people. I told you about Ga people. They are also Benin people, but they don't speak these languages anymore, because your immediate environment tends to have more influences than your long-term environment. Alright? It's even a cultural thing. Alright? Now, there was a medical doctor, Dr. Aishenekha Goswami, he's an historian, and he told me some time ago that the Benins, they're very tall people. Very tall people. Huge, tall. We take preferences on being physically built in the home. He said, but we're not that tall. He said it was just because one of our cuisine got missing. And one of those ingredients, whether pepper and all that, but in this case, salt. Now, what the old Benins were making as salt was a dried plantain back when you peel that plantain. So they'll dry it, all right? They'll dry it, then now mash it, now becomes powder. That was their salt. Until one of the other Oroboa went in traveling through the sea, now introduced salt about 600 years ago. So he was actually taking a DNA sort of sample. He's a retired medical surgeon and said that that's where that particular cuisine that was added to our food, dietary pattern, affected our height. So it happens that if something as minute that was introduced or something that had a general effect on the eventually other future generations of the Benin, we're not talking about being surrounded by every other ethnic nationalities for over 500 years. I give 50 years. If you stay in Benin 50 years, you would have almost lost everything that is Iwuruha. I know you're ancestrally Benin, but you now begin to behave like us. I think that's exactly what has happened. Now, but what I can assure you, the ancient. Okay. Sorry. The ancients, while GBD will be working with IFM, is that because we have not made practical move to study the present culture and traditions of the Imura people, their languages, we will not be able to do comparison and differences between these two ancestrally connected people. Until you start to speak Yoruba to me frequently, and I begin to hear words, and I begin to say, ah, that thing you said, see what it means for Benin. In all your festivals, if we begin to attend it frequently, we'll now begin to see touches. I'm so certain that there are still touches of the traditions and culture Akalaka brought from Benin, Igbo, but they have not been a concerted effort to cultural study. What I call cultural study, I come to Umuroha, if there's a festival going on, I sit down and see how it has been displayed. When we went to a fair, there were, I was then, the Yeze logo was there, like, I delivered the lecture publicly. I think it was the official inauguration of Ujubani Ekbe that brought Professor Dulua. I was there, I delivered the lecture. And before I started to deliver the lecture, they brought about four masquerades. And two of that masquerade dresses exactly like a kokonute. We call them a kokonute masquerade in Benin. Exactly. And I told them that these two masquerades are carbon copy of the masquerades we have in Benin. That are we sure that these masquerades are not from Benin? So they said, no, not actually from Benin. That probably when Akalaka was living, he had a concept of how this masquerade was, and he was able to give them that concept. That's because we just spent 1 or 2 days with the Ekpaya people. So if we were able to do that with our people here, we'd be able to see similarities in languages, similarities in our cultural practices, and they'll now begin to extract all these things out and use it to build a more stronger relationship that we ought to have built even years before now. I don't know whether you understand. Yes. Thank you very much.
To add to what my CGL just said, now when you're talking about the similarities between the Benin culture and the Worona culture, you should also take into cognizance that Akalaka had other children, Ogba, Ekpeye.
Yeah.
And if you look at the Ekpeye people, the Ogba people, you would pick some things that would clearly indicate a Benin ancestry. When a vehicle came into the land, an Ogba man sat with us and we got talking, and I told him, you guys are Igbo. He said, bro, no, we're not the Igbo. We're from Benin. I said, really? He said, yes. He now said, our traditional ruler even is called Ogba. Now, that's definitely not connected to Igbos in any way. And these are people who are in rivers here calling their traditional ruler Ogba. He also told me, he said, the first son, I think he said in his place or in one other riverine nationality here, he said the first son is called Osaru. Osaru, which is a pure Benin name. God has done it. He said, when we get to sit down more and bond more, we'll identify more of the similarities and have stronger, authentic arguments, not based on propaganda. Because some of us here are Puritans. If we are not related, we will tell you we are related, but we know we are, and we should build on our unity. Thank you.
I think this small talk, maybe to just use that it's really, really, really interesting and exciting. But before I go, as a representative of where you are, which is Sobia, I will also use this opportunity to permit me, sir, to welcome you once more officially. One pertinent issue I want to just ask or raise is the issue of documentation. Because, like what he mentioned, I know I have a little bit of that history. I've read something like that, where when the Oduduwa was sending the son, after the son gave birth, the one he gave birth to couldn't talk, so he sent a gift. That one, when that broke, something like a pebble broke, and I spoke. So as he spoke, that's where the gave him the name Ewata or something like that. So some of those things are rusty to us. We now that know some of this is rusty. Is there a particular document or a book that will help those coming at our back, or maybe our children when we start giving them, to learn these things? So to not what you're doing now will not phase out or go. And secondly, is there a regular kind of meeting where GBD try to, or national meeting where GBD carries a cross or spread his shoulders round, that these persons, like we, the normal people, would also come and also familiarize ourselves, so that it will help also to give us that sense of belonging?
All right, thank you very much. The first one,
yeah, there are a lot of documented works on some of these things, but it's largely inadequate. I must admit, not the relationship between Benin and Ife. That one is very largely adequate. No one would dwell on that, that's so much. When we went to Oga, we met with their paramount king, the Oga Marcher. I told him, His Majesty, that we are here to, first of all, tell you people that we are all connected, which he said, yes, we are. I said, the second phase is for we to set up academic committees between Benin and the Gar people. That's exactly when I delivered a speech to the Oluwa Warrior. That's exactly what I told him. I said, yes, the history of the Benin connection with the Shekiri people is a very straightforward thing. They don't get to argue that. But however, it's still inadequate. There should be more research that has to be done. So what I am proposing, I also propose it to Professor Dula Apa, the President General of Zubanikube, that it's high time that every of these ethnic nationalities that traces their ancestry to Benin, we should find a committee that will set up a more of like a research
joint committee
to put heads together to write a robust academic work documenting the interconnection, how these ancestors of these people left Benin, so that we can have a robust history, like an encyclopedia, that we can give to the future generations to learn from, so that they don't follow the path that we are following, because the path that we are on now is a very difficult one. We are trying to make that proper correction, because if we miss it now, we might have the future generations that will agree for them to be called Igbo.
Dwelling on hearsays.
Yes, based on hearsays. So we must put things together. I agree. Some of this history are inadequately documented, but the onus now lies upon us with the scratch of ideas of history that we still have remaining to put a more elaborate and a complex history together, so that the future generations can have something to back on. So I think that's the first question. Oh, is it the second?
That's the first question.
The second one was?
Second one was a general meeting.
Okay, the general meeting. Obviously, I think the River State coordinator of GBD is not here today.
Yes.
For breaking communications and all that. Couldn't reach him, but he was supposed to come. I will speak with the president.
Yes.
To allow him, allow IFM members to also participate in GBD meetings. Because GBD is just a social cultural group that with this more history will connect all of us. So that through him, he gets materials a lot from him. He can be able to constantly educate every of the moral people that come for that meeting, so that we can have a more enlightened people on our connection. So I think we have a river in GBD, Mr. Kenneth Ogu,
yes,
from Ekbeye, and we'll find a way for IFM to attend meetings, equally GBD members to attend IFM meetings as well, so that there can be that strengthening of bond. And by next year, I can assure all of you we are going to do something beyond summit. We're going to do something like a symposium, a seminar. It'll be two, three days. And what we're going to be talking about, we're going to be inviting professors from different historical background across this all Benin descendants to talk on how we can bring materials, to talk on our relationship and how we can gather materials to have a robust history that unites all of us. Thank you.
How many questions?
Yes.
Any more after this? Okay, these two last questions.
IFM.
You're first.
Ma'am.
IFM.
First of all, thank you, President. Welcome to Iran. The first thing I want to ask, I want to bother you to help us spell the Benin version of Iran so that some of us can have it. No, I want to write it down.
So, okay.
The first thing is you help us with the correct spelling of the Benin version of Iran. The next thing I want to ask is, my brother here said, so that we won't dwell on propaganda. I once heard that an Iran street or clan or whatever exists in Benin. I want to know how true this is. The third thing I would request is, there's also this propaganda. I don't know if I should call it propaganda or fact, but I want us when we talk, we want to be as bold as possible, knowing that we are saying the truth. They say when a Benin warrior or a Benin prince leaves Benin, that he is made to drop his culture, his language. How true is this? They say you're going to a new place. You are made, the culture of Benin puts it on you to drop the Benin culture or the Benin language. And most of us might have been using this in error, or without knowing we might be using the truth. So you are the next to everything Benin I can see today. So how true is this?
Okay. Thank you.
Your third question is very tricky. I see what I can do about it. The first one is Wiriona, Uwuriona. Wiriona.
Uwuriona.
Wiriona. Okay, if okay, there's a G-H-I, U-W-U-G-H-I-R-O-I-O-N-A,
Wiriona.
Okay, okay, yes, U-W-U-G-H-I-R-O-I-O-N-A, Wiriona. Okay, that was the first question.
Yes, sir.
So the second one was
The second question. We've been told many times that an Imran street or clan,
okay.
exists in Benin.
Not as Uwuriona, but the your father, Akalaka, has a street. You know, sometimes, like I said, circumstances, environment could be instances where names could be given. We have three streets, all interlocked, they are all adjacent. Alaka Street. Alright? Then we have a quarter. Ogbe Laka. Alright? Then we also now have a place called Ogbe Nalaka. What that means, it's called Ogbe Nalaka. What it inherently means, there's a quarter called Ogbe. That's the seat where the Oba is. Ogbe. Then where it meets Alaka, there's a junction, a four junction, we call it Ogbe Nalaka. Alright? So we believe that Akalaka would have been indigenous to that quarter. Where that quarter does not have is not an ancestral home base for anybody. What it means is that nobody is ancestrally from that quarter. You could be from Ogba, alright? If you have a function in the services of the palace, you'll be moved to that quarter. Obelaka. Alright? So we believe that the parents of Akanaka could have given birth to him around the Obelaka areas, both from ancestrally from Ogba, the information that we have. So that's why he had to name his second son, obviously, Ogba. Ogba. But we call it Ogba. Just the same spelling, but just different pronunciation. Now, the third question is tricky. But however, I'm in the midst of my people. You know, there are things we don't say, but we cannot keep secret from our people. The Benin language in the old was ascribed as sacred. On no account should a foreigner who is not of Benin descent be allowed to speak the language. It was sacred, the language of the Ogisos. It is still a common problem that still affects us, that our language speaking still revolves around just Benin. It was termed as a language too sacred to be spoken outside the boundary of the Benin lands. So when any Benin man lives, he knows that custom of not teaching outsiders a sacred language. So they tend to lose it and imbibe the languages of their neighbors, because there is no abomination when he speaks it as a Benin man, but there is an abomination when he teaches that language to those who are not Benin. So it was because of that, those who left Benin preferred to imbibe the languages of
their neighbors.
Of their neighbors. Rather than the languages they have. Yeah. Because of the sacredness, you know, Benin is still, there's a popular saying, as I said, we're doing it. If you get to a do, it's still very far. And we are, the major reason that our monarchy, our traditions and culture is still held in high esteem to date is because of so much sacredness and secrecy to date. So this is one of the story you should know, because you know Benins are the most prideful people on earth, so they cannot phantom a foreigner speaking the same language with them. It was an abomination. I don't know whether you understand. So there was a law, an outstanding law.
When you eventually, for whatever historical reasons, for whatever truth that transpired that made you wrong and all that, or left voluntarily to establish your own plans and all that, you must not allow anybody, you must not teach anybody your language, because it's like a secret language that we must use to connect. The foreigner must not learn our secrets. Now there's a parable encoded in Benin, Ginozikala Zeka, Ginozuduga Zudu, Amazebo Tawi. What that means, I'm going to explain. If you're an Eka speaker, speak Eka. If you're an Udo speaker, speak Udo. If you don't speak your language, you're more like a foregone person. Now that means we cherish the sacredness of language. We will not allow you to speak as. We will not also take yours from you. That was why every single kingdoms that Benin conquered would never enforce a language. Otherwise, the entire southern part of Nigeria would have been speaking Benin. So there seems not to be any place that we didn't conquer. But however, we understand the sacredness of language. So the only thing
we understand is that, okay, you want to meet people in their houses. You beat them, ask them. You still will take their language from them. Because I understand that the most fundamental aspect of human's identity is languages. So, having defeated them in their home, you are not supposed to take that most important part of their culture, which is language. Just beat them, take over their leadership. I don't really understand. Yeah. So if it was by enforcing of language, however, we quarrel all the time, Charles.
Zero.
We quarrel all the time that our ancestors made mistakes for not enforcing their language. But however, they understood humanity better than us. I have defeated you, I still will take the language from you. That is inhuman. Inhuman. So let me beat this guy, but let me not take his identity from him. You can be who you are. But the only thing, the Oba was just interested. Every year come and pay your homage. When you don't pay homage, bring war to you. Come and be paying homage. That's the only thing they were interested in. So we're not interested in taking people's language because our language was also dear to us. So every other people's language, we also knew how dear it can be. Today now we now see that just a few years after the British came, sharing southern part of Nigeria, some half, you know, Edo and Delta was under Old Western Region. As soon as it was under Old Western Region, the only thing Yorubas wanted to do is to enforce the Yoruba language on us. Yes, they forced some part of Omo, Yafuze, Far Edono to speak Yoruba. Those people still speak Yoruba till then. If you don't speak Yoruba at one point in time, you are not allowed to be a regional parastatus. These are people who are tribalistic. The same thing Igbos do all the time. Spend some few years in their house, they'll want to enforce their language upon you. The Benins had 600 to 700 years to do that. Yet we never did. Now, power was given, we understood what power should be. Now, power was just given to these people for less than 50 years. They want to just tribalize everything. I think that's why Nigeria is not working. Because when you have this set of people who doesn't think between, beyond their tribal cycle, you are bound to have a country that will not succeed. So, Benin had a country that was perfect because they understood what leadership should be all about. And every one of us must be proud for being a Benin man. That doesn't take our own. I'm also an even wrong person. So I should start learning the language. So Mecca, Mecca. He uses that a lot for me. So I'm really excited. I think we still have one question. So I will just take the last question.
I'm Mika. President, I greet you.
Thank you very much.
My name, I'm Amadi Christopher C.
That's a lot of Benin name. Amadi is a Benin name. Okay.
My question.
I'm sorry, I had to call you short. What was the meaning of that? Stop yourself. I want to learn your language.
What?
It's not that.
I'm including because all the while I've seen women, but the greeting is not including them, so I greeted to include all of the women.
It's something
right, that's what I'm talking about.
So that just
when
I speak, I really tell me
how to do that. Thank you very much.
All right.
My question is, this movement, I like it. However, I'm a goal getter. I like purpose. I'm purpose driven. And that is where I'm asking my question is driven from. What is the short time and the long time goal of this movement? That is one. And two, as a means of sustainability, we have this discovered that one thing about our government is that government comes too late, and when another government comes, it abandons the project or whatever the program is and goes on to another program. As a means of sustainability, I am suggesting, this is a suggestion now, that we can go into where you made mention about the literal materials as history book,
yeah,
a compilation of all of that, where we can also do a little deliberate intentional action to put that into the educational sector at the primary, secondary, and also the tertiary school, so that that can help us to sustain this movement.
Alright, thank you very much. Me and Emeka, we have spoken
for a while.
We had an incredible intelligent ancestors. At the time when the Portuguese came, alright, they first visited Benin, 1472. Alright, he didn't spend some time. Sequeira left. And Diabero came in 1485. Diabero spent his later part of life and died in Benin and was buried at Owotan, the Portuguese. Now, they came with all their sweet talks and ideas. And the Oba at that time said, I don't understand the ways of these people. In order for me to understand the ways of these people, let me also have my own people visiting Portugal. So the Benin were the first to have an ambassador in this part of the world. So ambassadors were sent, Benin natives, to learn. An embassy was created in this one. And in turn, the Portuguese also created an embassy in Benin. Diplomatic ties. Me and Emeka will spoke about that there should be infusion of ideas of IFM in GBD. And GBD and IFM. The reason is because you talked about short term and long term. The short term goals of GBD is, we don't know how Nigeria will be tomorrow. We don't. Whether it survives beyond 50 years, whether it survives beyond 100 years. Should, in case it doesn't survive, the Yorubas will not claim Oduduwa are going to come, Oduduwa Republic, isn't it? Because we are not united, and that's why some people are just saying Biafra. Oh yeah, come here. Go for it. Come here. Because we don't have a concerted effort on our own. Now, when we have identified all 50 ethnic nationalities in Nigeria that have been in ancestry. If we bring all these people together, do you think any Oduduwa, any Biafra will be able to marshals in wealth, in education, in every ramification? That could be the long-term goal. But the short-term goal is, we have to first of all put in our consciousness how ancestrally connected we all are. It's only when you are comfortable as an Iguru and man that you are ancestrally Benin man that you want to do something that contains Benin. So that is the short-term goal, education, educating our minds of our connectivity, how ancestrally connected we are. Then after we've been able to consciously educate our minds that we're actually one equal people, then we can be able to say, okay, fine, let's have one agenda and let's pursue it. With unity, we'll be able to achieve it. That's a long-term goal. Short-term goal, education, long-term goal. Coming and having a futuristic agenda. It could be anything. We are just starting it. It could be that we want to declare a nation of ours.